Today, for the very first interview at CCTV, we have chosen a wonderful topic, GHS in North America. As you can see on the cartoon, there are blueprints ready now in North America for GHS, the GHS block building syndrome, it's sometimes called. Europe discarded a few blocks, used some new blocks, and of course in Asia they already implemented many of the building blocks. Today we talk about GHS together with Karen Levens from Intertek Kentox. Karen is a regulatory toxicologist for more than 20 years with a big global experience. But of course, she's very well versed in North America, being the USA, but especially her home country, Canada. Karen, in your Canada, WMIS is replaced by HPR soon. Can you tell us more about that?
Sure. The WMIS, the Workplace Hazardous Materials Information System, is actually going to retain that acronym. Many people are calling it WMIS 2.0, the next version, which will adopt the GHS influences. It will be a significant overhaul of the WMIS program. So the system overall in protecting worker safety is still going to remain WMIS. What's going to happen, though, is the classification system that was traditionally in place will be replaced with the GHS-inspired rules. So we will start to see the building blocks be put in place under a house that's still called WMIS, but we'll be remodeling the inside of that house to reflect the GHS requirements. The biggest difference, I think, that most companies are going to see, especially, you know, the product stewards and product safety specialists who are responsible for helping their companies comply. I think that the largest difference they'll see is under the existing system, you only had to pull in information that was readily at your fingertips. And quite a number of companies would rely, for example, on supplier safety data sheets, or material safety data sheets, as the Canadians call it. And they would take the supplier information and from that build their own safety data sheets, their own classification of their own products. And you really didn't, there wasn't an expectation to go out into the literature and collect up all the information that was out in the published domain. What we're seeing, though, in adopting the GHS program is there is absolutely going to be that expectation that people who are responsible for classifying their substances now, those folks are now going to have to go out, do the literature, review the information that's out there, make some decisions about the reliability or the validity of that information, and then take that information, choose what they think the characteristics of their molecule is based on the information they collect, and make their own decision.
With the version we discussed is the draft version, do you expect a lot of change with the final version of the new regulation?
GHS is actually welcomed, for the most part. I shouldn't classify all Canadian industry as the same, otherwise I'll be getting some phone calls on when I get back to the office. But, you know, the large trade associations, for the most part, are embracing GHS. We recognize that Canada has a place in the global supply chain. We have pushed back and postponed adopting GHS until our number one trading partner, the United States, adopted it. So when we saw Europe adopting it, and when we saw the Asian countries, you know, moving ahead, Australia, for example, as well, you know, there was some pressure for Canada to pick it up, and we said, no, not until the U.S. does. Well, then the U.S. did. So then there was a push to say, okay, well, now that the U.S. is adopting it, there was a push to the Canadian government to hurry up and get it in place.
As you indicated, the United States implementation is also the 1st of June, like many other CLP in Europe, Canada probably also then some deadlines. In the United States, do you think industry, having 7 months left, is prepared for this new deadline?
Well, and let's be clear, there's a June 2015 deadline for manufacturers. What I think of as the molecule owners, and certainly the because of the need to sort of stagger the expectation that distributors who are in essence waiting for manufacturers to collect up their information about their products and then pass that information on to the distributors who then modify what paperwork they need to modify before they then subsequently get their products off the shelf. So there's a two-step staggered compliance deadline, the June 2015 as well as the end of the year 2015.
GHS is revised every 2 years, so since 2003. I mean, much more simple than the changes in North American legislation. Do you expect the next revision in 2015?
Sure, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, the mandate stands. So yes, they're actually working on the sixth version now. You know, it's every expectation it'll come out on schedule. The last ones all have. Will we see a change to the act or a regulation in response to that? I think that the governing bodies would have to look very carefully at the impact and the amount of effort, what I call the return on investment. How much are they getting in terms of improved worker protection, worker safety, hazard communication for the amount of effort it would take to change a law, to change a regulation? If it can be fixed or addressed or updated in a guidance, that's a lot easier. But that return on investment is going to be very important.
Karen, thank you very much for your expert opinion. I'm looking forward to the final Canadian blueprints of GHS and potentially other changes in North America in the coming period. So once again, thank you very much for sharing your knowledge with us.
Thank you so much for the invitation.